that. So we'll start the presentation. So point of discussion, so today what are things we are going to discuss is, one is pre-writing and writing skills and the intervention for that. So definitely every child is different and they have achieved each and every milestones at a different level. So as I know, majority are the parents here. So just understand where your child is stuck, and accordingly, I made the intervention. So accordingly, you can take inputs from here, or if at all you have a challenge, please feel free to ask the questions accordingly. Why handwriting is important? Anybody would like to share their thoughts, just to understand what are your perspective as a parent. Anybody would like to answer?
I would like to answer. I'm Priyanka from Calcutta.
Hi, ma'am. Please go ahead.
For me, handwriting is a mode of expression. And for our kids especially, errorless teaching is very important. So my son is 5 right now and he's writing. So on the very first, I want to pay attention also to the handwriting and not just the writing skill, so that he learns right in the very first time.
Yes.
And by writing, I think some kind of development, cognitive development also happens. The imagination power increases and everything.
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for answering, Priyanka ma'am. So definitely writing is a very complex task. Though we see, okay, writing is just we take a pen and write something on the paper. But it requires a lot of immense skills. It requires a fine motor, cognition, visual perception, visual motor integration, motor control. We are going to learn about it in detail. But why it is important? Definitely it is a mode of communication. It is maybe one of the academic achievements. So mode of communication, at times you want to express yourself, you write down. Sometimes it depends on everyone's personal choice, but majority prefers to write their thoughts in a paper, on a paper, to express themselves, feelings and ideas. And though we have a vast use of computers and keyboards nowadays, but if at all comes to write a personal note or write something, you prefer to write down with your with the pen and paper. And if child is a school-going child, and the way our academic system is designed, majority of our child is spending their time in writing. So that definitely handwriting consumes much of our student school days, right? So consequences of handwriting difficulties. If child is having difficulty with handwriting, what it may affect their scores. It may take longer to finish their assignments, problems in taking notes. At times, they are not able to achieve the higher level of writing skills like compositions and all if they have a challenges with their writing. And at times, due to as they have their own challenges, so they avoid writing. Example, if we are not so great with cooking, we will definitely not going to invite the guest for the, like if you need to cook, you're not going to invite the guests for the dinner or lunch, right? So that's how the writing avoidance develops. Okay? And definitely a self-esteem. Like if they are in the school or if they are in a group setting, if one child is able to do it and a child is not able to do it accordingly. So they definitely, we don't compare as a grown-ups, but they do have their own comparison. They do see what they are positives, what they are negatives, and definitely it affects their self-esteem. So that's why it is very, very important. So what are the red flags which we need to, when we need to decide that definitely my child may need some intervention? So if child is having difficulty in holding writing tool, now writing tool is either this is how we hold any writing tool, but at times child is holding the writing tool like this, or child is avoiding due to the tactile hypersensitivity. They are not able to grasp it appropriately. They are avoiding to hold any writing tool. A child is having difficulty in copying shapes, numbers, or letters. और डिफिकल्टी विद फॉर्मेशन ऑफ लेटर्स, इलेजिबल लेटर. दो चाइल्ड इज एबल टू राइट बट इट्स नॉट रेडिबल, लाइक वी आर नॉट एबल टू रीड द व्हाट दे हैव रिटन. सो दीज आर द बेसिक एरियाज वेयर वी नीड टू, इफ चाइल्ड इज इन एनी ऑफ दिस वी मे नीड टू सी टेकिंग अ प्रोफेशनल हेल्प. नाउ स्टेजेस ऑफ राइटिंग. सो it is very important how the development occurs in the writing, so, to understand the child's development, that where my child is. So first is imitation. What is imitation? Imitation is, like example, you give a drawing, imitation, you give it and then child does it. Imitation, child imitation, he imitates, do what I do, like simultaneously you are doing it and he is also doing it simultaneously. Copying, you draw and he copies you, that is write what I show you. Dictation, you say write standing line or you give a word depending on the child's level. And composition, give a composition, write my mother or write my favorite food. So this is how the stages of writing develops. This is just for you to understand when to expect what. Okay, development of pre-writing and handwriting in young children. So scribbling, just random scribbling starts. If you give younger kids any writing tool, they just start like this scribbling, random scribbling. It starts from age 10 to 12. Imitates the horizontal, vertical and circular mark by age of 2. Okay? Copies vertical, horizontal and circles by age of 3. Copies cross, oblique, square letters and numbers by age of 4. And copies, last comes a triangle. So 4 comes a square. This is how you can remember. This is a 4 and square comes by age of 4. And triangle, which is the complex one, which comes by age of 5 or 6, between 5 to 6. Copies most upper and lower case. So this is how the development occurs, and these are the developmental expectations, what ideally it should come. And this is just for your understanding how the development of grass occur. This is a very primitive grass, cylindrical grass. Then the digital palmar grass. That is between age of 2 or 3, they start doing this. Then slowly it refines and it develops a modified tripod where they use like this. It is modified tripod. And then last comes the tripod grip. It comes like this. This is a tripod grip. And it gets refining from 4.5 till 7 years of age. Now this is very, very important when we are going to understand the sub-components of writing. So these are the pre-writing, prerequisites for writing. So we'll just name it. One is postural stability, hand dominance, crossing midline, letter identification, visual perception, visual motor integration, in hand manipulation, grasp, hand strength, auditory processing, memory, and attention. So these are the prerequisites. Imagine so many subcomponents you need to assess when child is having difficulty in writing. So we'll start with the first one, which is a postural stability, which is very, very important, and at times we miss on it. So make sure that child is having an adequate, appropriate sitting arrangement where either a table or chair, or a child is sitting cross-legged, then child is having appropriate a desk with him. Okay, so maintain their balance. So what is postural stability? It is maintain their balance in sitting position without using their hands. So if child is sitting, child should not be able to do this, or child should have a proper postural stability so that he doesn't require extra hand support to balance his posture. So if child is doing it, so definitely child requires we need to work on child's postural stability. The chair should allow the child to sit comfortably where see here on the picture. The feet is touching the ground, comfortably flat. Our back is erect, okay? And bottom well back on the sit. So this is how the ideal posture of the sitting should be. Next, how we can develop the postural stability by exposing them with lots of playground equipments like a merry-go-round, where they require lots of balancing, then slides, swings. These are all equipments going to improve their postural stability. Next comes the obstacle cross, including lots of crawling and climbing. I would like to share this video. The crawling in the obstacle cross like this. Okay, so this type of obstacle course you can make it at home. So if you don't have a channel, you can use the chair, big chairs, and your child can pass through the big chair. So this is how you can make a tunnel and improve the crawl. You can do the lots of crawling, or you can make them crawl on the bean bags or a pillows. You can arrange the pillows and ask them to crawl on the pillow. So this is how you can work on the postural stability. Their shoulders get stronger, their hip joints get stronger. So if the trunk and the posture, if trunk is having a good, if trunk is strong, it can support our distal function. If possible, that the main midline is the middle portion of our body is strong, which kind of supports our distal hands, like hand, fine motor. So this is very important to have a good postural stability and even a core strength. Next is we can give them a twister game, or Simon Says, jumping on a trampoline, dancing, skating, swimming, gymnastics. So definitely therapy is very, very important, but kind of giving an opportunity which can even develop, which can help in taking a hobby also, kind of like skating, swimming, gymnastics, which this can even kind of, it may help in their therapeutic purpose, plus it also add into their hobby, and which child would definitely enjoy. Then wall press or chair push-ups like this. Chair push-up is child is sitting and child is pressing down and pushing himself up like this. So this is a chair push-up and the wall press like this, the way I've shown in the image. So this is how you can work on the postural stability. Lots of vertical surface activity. Anything you can give vertically, like giving a coloring, or giving a writing on the vertical surface. Otherwise, using the sticker. Use the sticker and ask them to stick on the wall like this. So this is what is going to help in improving their shoulder stability, extending their elbow and the wrist extension. So lots of vertical surface activity like this. Other is a core strength. Now core strength, as I said, the postural stability and core strength goes hand in hand. Okay, so have a good postural stability, core strength needs to be there. If core strength is there, definitely postural stability would be. So it goes hand in hand. So what are things we can do is core stabilize. So core stability helps stabilizing our head, neck and the shoulders. And definitely shoulders helps in supporting the arm and the elbow and the wrist. And what are things we can do is like yoga. Games like yoga spinner, flashcards, and the books. We have a different types of books which we use it here. So these are the different yoga books. What I'll do is whatever activities which I'm listing here and which I'm using it, I maybe find out the links and share it with ma'am. She may share it with you guys. So this is a yoga book. The first image is from the game like yoga spinner game. So where the child has to spin and whatever color card comes and they have to make that activity. So this is from one of our group activity session, that first image. So these are the different types of visual image. So this helps child because if there is a visual depiction, so it becomes easy for child to understand the yoga poses, and it definitely helps in it. And the games like a yoga spinner, they really enjoy it. So you can use this type of activities. other is animal walk. Like everybody must be knowing about it. If at all any queries, feel free to ask. So walk like a crab walk, bear walk, seal walk, frog jump, dog walk. Okay, so these are the different types of animal walks you can work on. This is a wheelbarrow activity where a therapist or a parent can hold their legs and they walk on their hands like this. Other is a very important thing I wanted to show was a exercise ball, sit on and so on the exercise ball which everybody must be having. So 1 minute, I just missed my ball, but it's okay. What I'll do is, so example, imagine this is an exercise ball and you can walk on, sit and bounce, which also stimulates their core muscle here. And then you can, if child is sitting on a ball and you push the ball backward, where child is trying to balance himself left and right, the movement of the trunk muscle here while you are moving the ball forward and backward, that brings a contraction of the core muscle, and that's how the core strengthening happens. So this is very simple and fun activity where, in a fun way, you can push the child backward on the ball, forward, left and right, which stimulates and activates their core muscle. Other important thing is hand dominance, which is very, very important for us to understand that we should never force child to use any particular hand. Why? Because the dominance of the initially, there is in both sides of our brain, the dominance is there. But over the period of time, the way our development happens, we start having preference to the one side of body. So example, if I'm using my right side of body, that means my left side of brain is dominant. And if we interfere in that, it affects the dominance of the brain as well. So avoid forcing the child. So when you are confused how to decide on whether what hand child would be preferring the more, so if you are confused, keep the writing tool in the middle. Keep it in the middle. Let child decide whether he wants to use right hand or left hand. So you keep in the middle and just observe what child is using. If child is using left hand, let him use left hand for that activity. That's fine. So whenever while not even just for writing, even for while doing the peg activities, pegboard activities or any activities, if you are confused, keep it in the middle. And then you keep a log that which hand child is using the most. Okay, so in a day you observe which hand he is preferring, whether he is preferring the left hand or whether he is preferring the right hand. So if he is preferring the left hand more throughout the day, then we will start refining the only left hand. Any question here? Because this is very, very important at times. Okay, so if child is using left hand more, so you are going to start refining. So you will work more on the left hand. Then you will start giving activities with the left hand. Whatever hand child prefers, you will start refining that particular hand. So observe the frequency of the usage and train the same hand accordingly. This was about the hand dominance. Or otherwise, you can remind the child by either you can put the sticker on it. For example, if I'm using my left hand and to remind myself this is my right hand, I may put the sticker on it, or I put the bracelet on it, or you can put the tattoo on it, or you can draw something on it. So this is how it gives a visual cue. Okay, this is the right hand I'm going to use it, or this is the left hand where I'm going to use it. So this is how you can remind them. Other is important thing is midline crossing. Understand, so why midline crossing is important? So if you see any letter or something, it definitely crosses the midline. Plus, if you are writing on a paper or a page, it is definitely crossing your midline. So if you are writing it, so you are writing like this. So it's somewhere here, this is my midline, but still I'm crossing my midline and I'm writing, right? If I'm going to pick up my pencil from here, so this, I'm crossing my midline. And it is very, very important to have a good midline crossing to form a shape, copy, draw letters, write a letter. So this is very, very important. And to understand both sides of hand when we are writing, this is our helper hand. So the dominant hand is working, but the other hand is our helper hand, which helps. So always remind the child to use their helper hand, and then you write. Okay, so this is how we work. So where there is a crossing of the midline while writing, and it is very, very important. So how you can use the cloth pegs on the dress. Okay, so example, I'm not having sleeve, but you can use the cloth peg on the other side and ask him to take it down. Or you can keep the coins, you can keep the pegs this side of the table, and keep the pegboard here, and then you are crossing the midline and asking him to put it here. So this is how you can use the different activities to work on the midline crossing. You can put the stickers in a different side, or you kind of give a targeting like this. So, and then you can use the racket. Or say, example, you draw number 8 here. There is number 8 here, number 3 here. So you ask them to touch the number 8 with midline crossing. Touch number 3. So I'm using my midline crossing and doing this. So these are just an example of the midline crossing. You can even think of it and make your own midline crossing activities. Other is a brain gym, where you cross the midline and touch the opposite sides of the leg with your elbow. This is crisscrawl activity. Other this very important thing is a lazy eight. Now when I'm demonstrating this, so this is a lazy eight activity, so it starts from the middle, it goes up, turn around, back in the middle, up, turn around, back in the middle. So this also helps in crossing midline. You can make a card, you can kind of make a card and ask, give a card to Shail and ask to draw it with the card. Trace the card track, you can draw a card track and ask the child to go on the card track using the card, or you can use a pen, a pencil, or a crayon, and to draw. And child should be standing on the middle of it, and then it should go up, turn around, back, and up, turn around. So it goes like this. Other important thing is white is important, it also helps in developing the letter formation. So if you see, this helps in developing A. It also helps in developing letter D. It also helps in developing letter P. It also helps in developing letter G. Okay? It also helps in developing letter B. So, this all the curvy letters we can form using the lazy eight. So, if child is having difficulty with the writing, you may use a lazy eight activity. It also helps in facilitating the midline crossing, and plus even developing the different letter formations. And to develop the grasp and the fine motor skills, I've just listed a few activities. There are n numbers of activities available, but what majorly we focus to improve their writing skills, this which I'm mentioning here, this is a very important. When we start with the first one is manipulating object. So example, what is manipulating object? Anybody? Can anybody explain what is manipulating objects? Anybody would like to share? Okay. Fine. So, manipulating object is how you are. Sorry, yeah, please go ahead. Anybody?
Ruthie, can I raise your hand?
Yeah, please go ahead.
To say something.
Yeah. So, yeah. I'm just attempting. Is it about moving the blocks around and keeping it in a certain way?
Yeah. Yes, correct. So, you are very clear to the answer. Yes, correct. So, manipulating object is how you are taking the object, how you are using the object. So example, this is a cap and I want to close my pen using my cap. So see, my it is in my palm, but I'm able to use my finger and bring it to my finger. So from palm to finger, I'm able to do it and I'm able to use it adequately. At times, this refinement of hand functions are not there. Turning the coin, okay? So it becomes challenging for the child. So this is what is important. So working on the activities, make sure at times you start working like this. Keep the coin in the middle. Keep the coin in the middle and ask them to turn around. And put it on a certain space. So example, from palm, child is able to bring it till here on the finger and put it, so you can turn, so you can say, give a command like, okay, show, put it on the black surface. So he will turn and then keep it. So the turning, moving around the object on your finger, though it looks simple, but when it is a challenging for the child, definitely it is a bigger task for the child to turn and keep it like this. Okay, so this is how you can work on the manipulation of object. It doesn't require any specific activity. Whatever you have at home, you can use different things. You can use a regular coin box and the piggy bank to kind of learn about the manipulation of the object. And there is a building block. Building block is very, very important activity for every child. First of all, it is an open-ended where there are not given any particular command or rules. Child can be very creative and create their own, use their own imagination and create a wonderful things. It can be a very engaging activities when child feels bored, and definitely it helps in refining, planning, thinking, problem solving. Requires lots of thinking to create anything. So it's amazing cognitive stimulating activity. Refining hand functions, which requires to use different sizes of blocks, so it helps in improving different size types of the grasp of the hand. So yeah, this is from our group sessions where we give free play like this, and they create and talk whatever they have created, they talk about it. This type of pegboard activities, now here in a pegboard there are different varieties. So we start with the gross, the bigger one, bigger pegs like this, okay? And slowly, if child is able to, for younger kids, we start with this, the bigger one, and slowly we refine it to the smaller pegs with which child is using it. Here child, and she's cleaning up. So this is the okay. So this is how, and then last peg is we are using the battleship, which is very refined, small. Why pegs are very important to develop a grip? Because see, when we are using the peg, we are basically majorly using first two fingers and support sometimes with the third finger, which is the same fingers used for our writing, developing the tripod grasp. So this is the finest refined one, the battleship. So this comes the last one. And here in pegboard, they have to fix it exactly on that dot. So example, if child is putting randomly, this is a different way we are working. But if I'm saying put it on letter A, all the letter A, so then I'm giving a particular target. So it even refines their motor control. Okay, they have to bring it till A, and exactly on the A, they have to fix it. So this is how you can work with their finer pincer grasp, and this helps in improving their tripod grip. So this is how you can progress slowly on the pegboard. You can work on the lacing and threading, even the bead stringing like this. You can use the bead stringing, basic ones. And then definitely craft activity, collage and pasting and cutting. Lots of craft activity where here the child drew this all the shapes, and then he cut all the shapes and he pasted on the paper. So this is how you can work on the craft activity, where you can work on the writing skills, imagination, and then even the seizure skills and pasting, which requires lots of sensory planning, thinking, and this is how you can work on. Other is, important one is a Lego, this type of Lego, the bigger one with the Lego plate. At times you can put a Lego plate on the vertical surface using the tape. We are actually using it on the vertical set, surface, and then you can use the blocks, which is also a very good activity to develop their shoulder, elbow, and the wrist joint. This is a Play-Doh activity where child can, you can give a picture like this, and child can take out the Play-Doh and put it on the particular design. So this is a Play-Doh plate or templates where child can fix it, the Play-Doh. And these are the different Play-Doh tools you can use it.
Meenal, if you have a question, please ask. Meenal has raised her hand.
Yeah, ma'am. Hello. Here, yeah, ma'am. What is it called, that clay plates, what you said?
Sorry?
Clay plates you mentioned, right?
What I mentioned? Sorry, can you please come again?
Clay plates.
Play-Doh templates.
Templates, okay. This is
not clear. Your, like you download something, laminate, and you can use it.
Okay.
So child can put it in the balloon, child can put it on the ice cream, like this.
Okay.
They can put it on the, they can make a flower, they can make a for the, so you can be creative like this. Rather than just kind of putting them protein stuff. You can use the different Play-Doh equipment like this. This you can, see this is a cookie cutter, you don't need to buy a fancy thing. Whatever you have at home, you can use. These are the plastic scissors, you can use Play-Doh. You can use Play-Doh with the plastic scissor. So you make a roll and then you cut the Play-Doh with the plastic scissor. These are the different tools for the Play-Doh.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, welcome. And this we use for the even the group sessions. I just want to share like how child creates some things and then we ask them to talk about it. Just a minute. Whatever child creates, give an importance that they really created something, and then you can add on to their vocabulary, ask them how did you make it, what color is it, what are things you made, and so that's how you can work even on the vocabulary. So definitely vocabulary also is important in developing a composition and all. So this is how you can work on even on handwriting. And so this type of activities, we use it even in the group. So that gives a self-esteem for the child that they came and talk about it, what they created. Keyboard activities, if child is interested to play any musical instrument, either any drums or a keyboard, that definitely helps in developing the isolation of finger or developing a rhythm or developing a that definitely even in the drums requires an isolation of finger following the rhythm. So those musical instrument is also amazing way to work on their refining their hand functions. Other important thing is, yes, we are talking about all fancy things and all, but if we focus basically on the life skills, so imagine when child is starting their day, it starts with the brushing their teeth, or using the washroom where they request to use manipulate their clothes, pulling it down, pushing it up, or using any kind of a zipper or closing the button, opening the button. If we see this only requires so many refined results, if child is independent, if we focus on the life skill independence only, we are won the half battle. So we are done with the half things if child is independent in his own life skills. So even the brushing teeth, so putting the paste on, so it requires the bilateral hand coordination to put the paste, then putting in the mouth, and the brushing, it requires a midline crossing, and then the same sides. Then cleaning the tongue requires a bilateral hand use. Then wearing the dress also requires a planning, thinking. Even for the writing, it requires a good amount of planning, thinking from where to start, up to down, left, right. Okay, so these are the, so this is for the writing. Then even for while using the, taking a bath, it requires a lot of sensory experiences, body awareness. Okay, serving the breakfast requires placing visual perception, lots of visual perception, understanding how much amount of force they need to use to serve themselves. Example, they're taking a sambar from the on the bowl. So it requires a lots of refinement of the hand functions, lots of planning, thinking, grading the pressure, how much pressure they need to use to manipulate just the basic things. Then eating requires a refinement of the hand function, breaking the chapati, breaking the dosa, breaking the idli, dipping it and eating. So it requires a lots of, even if they are using the eating tools like a spoon or a fork, that also requires a good amount of hand functions. So this is about the eating, dressing, bathing, toileting. So this, if we focus on function is taken care of, you may just need to work on the basic functional refinement of the hand functions. But try to make the child more independent. I know there are lots of, each child is different and they have their own different struggle, but emphasize on the life skills. It is very, very important. Or mixing in ingredients and helping during cooking, while cutting the vegetables or mixing the ingredients if they are making a dough, okay, rolling a chapati or turning the dosas, pancake. So this all helps in improving their, so while turning the pancake or a dosa, it requires a turning of the hand, which is called supination and pronation, which is also part of the writing skills. Different activities like a connect four, where you drop the coin of the same size. So this is a smaller version of the connect four. There are the bigger coins also. And then you can either give it here or put it on the table and ask them to pick it up. So it requires a different way you can put it, or you can put it in a silver foil and ask them to open and then drop it. So this is how you can work one activity in a different way, or you can hide the coins inside the theraputti and then ask them to take it out and drop it in a connect four. So this is how you can be creative and work on the hand functions. We'll definitely talk about the therapeutry again in detail. So this is how different way you can work one activity in a different way. Cloth pegs, which everybody is aware, which is, I'm sorry. Or we can use the medicine dropper for transferring from one to another one. Popping bubble wrap, which we get it in all the all the courier times. You can use those things to improve their work on their hand function, because it is exactly on that they have to press. So it helps in even grading their pressure, how much amount of pressure they need to do to pop the bubble wrap. So you can use this type of activity. Otherwise, you can use this magnetic pencil board like this. I'll be sharing the link of activities from where you can buy. So this type of, which requires a good amount of force, because, and then pull it out. You can use this type of activity. Play-Doh, which we already discussed. Therapeutic. We can use it in a different first you can work on the pressure. So you ask them to squeeze. There are different grades of therapy. Putty, those who doesn't know, this is the highest grade, that is a black in color. The lower to this is a blue color, and lower to that one is a green color, and at the lowest is a yellow color. Basically, preferred is either start with the green, blue, and the black. Basically, otherwise, child who's having a medium strength, you can start with the blue and then go to the black. And those who are having the adequate strength, you can use the start from the black only, where you can first ask them to squeeze the therapy. Otherwise, you can ask them to pull and bring it back. Another important thing is you can ask them to roll. You can roll the therapy. Roll using both the hands or using one hand. You can ask them to use one finger. So this will help even in refining the finger isolation. And ask them to press or ask them to pinch like this. Or you can ask them to use the coin and press it inside. And then you can ask them to take it out using the same thumb and finger. Or you can hide the coin or a bead inside. Ask them to squeeze it inside and ask them to look it for it. So find it out using their thumb and finger. So this is also a very good activity for the small ones. Therapy is an amazing investment for all the child who is having challenge with their writing, especially with the developing a grip. Or it also, so having a grip also, and then endurance, developing an endurance. So definitely it is a very good activity even for the self-regulation also. Squeezing the therapy helps them to regulate themselves because it gives lots of proprioception. So it is even, you can use it as a regulatory function. Any question till now? Okay. We'll go ahead. So, tweezer activity, which is very, very important, because the muscle used for the tweezer and the writing are the same muscle. So, if your child is having difficulty with developing a grip, definitely you start working on the tweezer activity. You can use it, use the pom-poms or whatever small objects you can use. So you can grade it, the tweezer activity. You can start with the biggest tweezer to the smaller tweezer like this, or you can start using the bigger object to the smaller object like this. So this is how you can grade the activity. These are the different types of tweezer. This is a kitchen tong. You can use the hair removal tweezer as well. The plucker, which is called. Okay, so next important thing is handwriting and visual motor integration. So visual motor integration is what? What we are seeing, how brain is interpreting, and then how we are bringing it in a motor response. So ability to integrate the visual image of letter or a shapes with appropriate motor response. So these are the important aspects. Before you start writing, make sure child knows how to draw. How to draw shapes. So one is like, we discussed this long back, but this is, So this is from the Handwriting Without Tears, where you can see down where the letters are derived from the shapes. Can you see down the square? So from square, there are many letters we can form. One is L, one is E, one is F. Okay? So if the circle is there, we can write A, we can write O. So, and then triangle, so using triangle we can use different letters like A, B, W. So our different shapes and the different shapes helps in developing or facilitates the writing. So instead of going for teaching them directly writing, you can ask them to draw different types of shapes. So first you can give them a circle. If child is able to draw independently, you can do different activities. You can be a creative and kind of make a different things using the shapes. Okay, let's make a cat using the circle. And this is how you can help in developing the writing skills. Okay, so same way you can make a different things, like using circle and the triangle, and then you can draw different objects like this. So you can be creative and you can use the shapes and develop their imagination, and this is how you can work on their pre-writing and writing skills. Other important thing is activity to develop the visual motor integration is copying pattern using the spoons, ice cream sticks, blocks. So you create something, example, let me see. We will get it to that. Or you can use the using the Play-Doh, shaving foam, or a sand. You ask them to, or you put the shaving foam and draw shape and ask them to copy you. Or you draw, write letters or a number and ask them to copy them. Or you can give a maze like this to develop the visual motor integration. Tracing activities. So, 1 minute, I think so. Okay, what I'll do is, I missed few images which I'll be sharing on this, how you can use it, tracing activities. Okay, I will be sharing it with the ma'am, which she will be sharing it with you all. So this was about the visual motor integration. Any query till now? Okay. Other is a motor control. Motor control is very important. When child is writing A, but child is writing this big A, where child is not able to control where he has to write between the lines. If child has to write between the lines, this is called a motor control. Between two lines, if I'm writing A, so I'm able to fit between my two lines. Okay, so this is a control which you can improve using the pegboards like this, where there is a target. Okay, put it on number 3, where exactly they have to put it on number 3. So this is how helps in improving their motor control. In younger kids, you can use activities like this. There is a patterns like this you can give, where child learns to be on the line, between two lines. So you can use, start with the bigger patterns like this and then refine it to the smaller patterns. And then once child excel both, you can merge both the types of, like bigger ones, bigger curves, then smaller curves between the two lines. And child has to copy the same pattern. So it also helps in improving their attention, their control, their strokes, the refinement of the strokes improves, the legibility improves over the period of time. So this is how you can work on the improving the motor control. Other important thing, if I'll talk about the sensory system, that itself would be another session. So if we need, we will definitely do it. But when we say learning, sensory system is the important part of learning. So if we see this triangle of learning, see, if you see the base of it, It is like there is a tactile system, vestibular system, proprioceptive, gustatory, auditory, visual, olfactory. So these are the basic sensory system. On that, the refinement of other functions occur. Sensory motor, which is like postural security, body schema, awareness of the two sides of body, motor planning, which is very, very important and needed for the writing. Then perceptual motor activity, postural adjustment, visual perception, and final comes the learning, academic learning. If you see the top of the triangle, that is academic learning. So base of the learning needs to be strong. So if your child is having any particular sensory challenges, make sure you address it, you work with your therapist, and you kind of work everything together, just rather than working on the writing. You need to break down whether it is a visual perception, whether it is a fine motor, whether it is a postural control, whether it is a sensory motor. So this is how you are going to now see where the child is stuck. If you are still not able to do it, take the professional's help, find out where child is lagging, and accordingly you work with your child's handwriting. That would be easier and you will achieve your goal faster rather than, you know, struggling. And it's a trauma for the child and parent, and I understand it is difficult as a parent. So different sensory diet, we are not going to talk in detail, but just to give you a gist of it, you can use the different therapy ball, cushions, which helps them to calm down before you start writing, make them sit for the writing so that their attention is better, their high energy level gets channelized, and they are focused on the task. You can use the theraband on the you can tie it on the chair, which is calming and which kind of they can fidget up with their legs. You can use the chair push-ups for the proprioception, which even prepares their shoulder for writing. Weighted lap pad. So you can use any soft toy which is a little bigger. You can add the sand or kind of for grains, which adds the weight around 1 kg or 2 kg, and you can put it on their lap, which is kind of calming for them. It helps for the attention, decrease the self-stimulatory behaviors. Or headphone with the music when they are writing. So it helps them to calm down, they are focused, what they are doing. So these are the sensory strategies which you can use. Or before starting with any sitting task, you can use slow rocking like this, forward and backward, in different positions. This is in the supine position. You can turn the child and even do it on the prone position like this, slow rocking. So whenever you want to calm down the child, any movement which you are doing with the child should be very slow rocking. It should be very slow. If child is high energy, you need to be slow. And child is very low, you need to be in a high energy. So whatever child is, you need to be opposite. And that is how you can help in regulating the child. You can bring the optimal arousal level for the child. Or you can use the deep pressure, which helps them to calm down. These are the different strategies we use it here, like therapeutic listening program, or generally instrumental music with the headphones, or vestibular activities. Other important thing is when we are talking about the sensory, messy play, which is very, very important on a developmental aspect. When child is in initial days, where child is not relating to the other people, when we start working on the sensory play, first they start exploring them, their own body. When sticky things touches them, so they explore their own body. And definitely we need to consider if child is a tactile hyper-responsiveness, we need to be very careful. We should not be forcing them too much. But at least even child is initially touching it, this much is also, it's fine. Slowly, slowly, as in when you will work with your therapist, and slowly, slowly, as in when you work with your child, definitely you will see the improvement with the child's comfortness with the touching different textures. So messy play plays a major role first to develop their own sense of self. When they are aware about themselves, then only they can connect to the other child or other person. So this is how the social development occurs. to develop their awareness about their own body, messy plays a major role. And these are the different ways you can do the messy play. On a pre-writing skills, you can do like this. You can either use the sand, colorful sand, kinetic, or you can use the salt, colored salt like this in a small tray. You can make a letters, you can ask them to draw something. You can otherwise use the colored noodles to touch and feel, and you can do this type of activities. Other thing is you can use the corn flour or other corn flour and colors. It becomes like this. Slowly, slowly becomes a. So this is how it helps. So these are the different. There are many, many sensory plays you, which messy play you can do it. Any waste from the kitchen, either it is a overripe papaya or a tomato or a banana, just mash it, give them to explode, or any outdated biscuits. Or anything outdated pastas, you can be creative. So don't throw anything. You can mix it. You can put some water. You can be creative. Okay. So this is how you can make a different texture messy play. Water balls. So this is also very good. You can use slime, Play-Doh. So this is how you can be creative for the messy play. Other is to improve the grip, apart from the tweezer, how to teach the child what is appropriate way. So what you can do is, you can keep the pencil on the table, pencil pointing towards the other side, and ask the child to use the thumb and finger first, and hold the pencil like this, and flip it over. Actually, this is I've taken from the Handwriting Without Tears program. So this is what they have demonstrated. Are we clear? So pencil is on the opposite side, pointing outward. You will ask the child to do this. Thumb and finger, hold the pencil and flip it around. And so this is the ideal way to hold the pencil. So to develop the grip, as I said, experiences like self-feeding, which will facilitate the easier in learning the writing or anything. The toys, generally, there is a huge, massive transformation in the types of toys available now. It is more of battery-operated. There are many app-based games and all. So, the toys, which is non-battery-operated, I would prefer keep child using more of non-battery operated toys, which helps in using and manipulating the toys, which helps in improving the strength. And this is the way you can teach them to have a correct grip. So this is the flip the pencil trick. It is called flip the pencil trick. And this is the actually the song for it. And this is also from the end. Thumb is always point to the tall man. This is a tall man. So it is. So this is a YouTube link. I will be sharing it. All the resources, I will make a list of it and I will be sharing it with the ma'am. She will be sharing it with you all. So this was about how you can make sure that child is holding with the tripod grip properly. So there is a song on it, and then the flip trick method where child can keep it, and then that's how you can teach the child. Other important aspect is the size of the tool, which type of tools we should be giving. If the child is younger child, which type of tools we can give? Anybody? Anybody would like to share? So using fingers, yes, anybody would like to share? Okay. Child is...
Raksha says fat crayons.
Fat crayons, okay. Okay, amazing. Okay, great. So, yes, fat crayons, but I'm not a very big fan of those big and thick and fat crayons. You can use them very early stage, but when you start kind of refining the grass, I would prefer you kind of take the crayon. Take the crayon and you break it. Okay? And when you're working, this is from the initial days I'm talking about. Instead of using those thick, yes, a little bit of thicker ones, but this is the ideal one, and then you can break, you can use those broken crayons, okay, the smaller one. So I'll just give you an example. So child is using the bigger crayon, which is bigger in the size, and see how the child is coloring. And the same child, when we gave a broken crayon, see the grip. The same day grip. So you can always break it to refine the grip. So when child is kind of grown up, but still child grip is not a tripod grip. It is not necessary that we need to have a proper tripod grip every time. Okay, if child is having adequate grip, child is able to ride without complaint, or he is not very slow, the speed is not an issue, legibility is not an issue. It is okay if child is having any adapted grip, like having this way or a thumb wrap and writing it. It is not necessary every time we need to correct it when child is grown kind of big enough and child is having some adapted grasp, either this way or a thumb wrap. But we have to make sure that it is not affecting his functionality like speed and legibility. Okay? Joints all are different. So there is a definitely variation in how everyone's body works. At times, yes, that is how it is the best for that particular child. So we need to accept that. Very important thing, placement of the paper. When child is a right-handed child, so I'm right-handed, so my hand and my paper needs to be in a parallel. So if I'm right-handed, I'll keep my paper like this, not like this. It should be parallel to my hand, right hand. If I'm left-handed, so this is my left hand, I'm left-handed, I will keep my paper position parallel to my left hand. So this is how I'm going to write. So this is very, very important, placement of paper. At times, child forgets to turn the paper. They write like this, and then they are not able to see what they are writing. So this is why it is very, very important to make sure that placement of
doing something.